Hey everybody, I've received some emails about wanting to give my opinion on the George Floyd incident, the unfortunate incident that happened. And I'm not going to give my opinion. What I like to do is state facts, and I'll let you guys have your own opinion. You know, on television, you can watch Fox News, which is slanted more conservative. And I like Fox News. I'm a fan of Fox News. And then you have all the other channels that are slanted more liberal, CNN, MSNBC, ABC, CBS. So there's a one channel called C-SPAN. And I really like C-SPAN because they just report the news. They don't talk about their opinion. You know, one of the things that I think is stupid too is these comedians will come out and start giving their opinion, you know, and it's like, you know, just go back to being funny. You know, you're not an intellectual. So I'm certainly not going to, you know, give my opinion, but I am going to share something from a biblical perspective. So let's put this in perspective. I want to show you, first of all, you know, George Floyd had gone to prison and he was arrested. I want to read something to you before. And then he did his time. So when someone does their time, you know, that's them doing their time. You know, they paid their punishment off. But I want to go through something with you because some people are making him out like he's like a saint and he was like a very nice, loving, kind person. And then some people are making him out like he's just the worst criminal and stuff. So notice he went to, he went 5 years for first degree felony. And then also it says, So also it said that he allegedly pointed a gun at a pregnant woman being involved in cocaine, white bag, baggy charges. I'll put some of these links below here. You could see this. But then you'll see a video about him where he's talking about these guys, you know, he uses the N-word and he's saying that they have guns and they act like they're all big and bad. But then he goes, I tell you, they go to bed with their knees shaking. So there's like a good side to him also. Now, let's go to what was, you notice they're not telling you, well, what was the initial, and we're going to talk about the what the police officer did too. And I'm going to predict, and I'm going to show you why, I'm not giving you my opinion on it, but from a legal standpoint, I'm going to show you why I believe the police officer is going to be found not guilty and we're going to have more riots. I'm going to show that to you. It has nothing to do with race, or it has to do with the law and the policy of the police department. I'm going to read that to you. You know, notice he was arrested outside a store. His arrest was captured on cell phone video. So you ever curious, well, what was the initial issue? So here's what happened. The ordeal started with what was believed to be a counterfeit $20 bill. On May 25, Floyd visited Cup Foods grocery store in Minneapolis to buy a pack of cigarettes. Store employee believed the bill he used to be counterfeit, reported it to police. The store owner, Mike Abumayala, I believe, said that he was not at work the day, but his employees told him that Floyd initially came into the store with a man and a woman. Now, I'm going to believe what the store employee said because, you know, they have no reason to lie or anything like that. Notice the man, not Floyd, the man tried to use what employees suspected was a fake bill, which the employee caught and gave back to the man. Abumayala said Floyd returned to the store about 10 minutes later and tried to use a suspicious $20 bill to make a purchase. The employee didn't realize it at first, according to Abanyula, but when they did, they followed protocol and called police. In a call to 911, this is what the employee said. The employee told the operator, so he basically gives Floyd the cigarettes, and Floyd, or I guess, has them there and has them in his hand, and the employee's like, hey, this is counterfeit, you know, give me the cigarettes back. But Floyd doesn't want to do that. You know, this is why the officer came out. So you have this potentially counterfeit $20 bill, and Floyd came in with the same people that had the $20 bill. Now he's coming back and he's, you know, trying to pass the $20 bill again for the cigarettes. This is what the employee is saying. The employee also claimed Floyd was awfully drunk and not in control of himself. Floyd was near the store sitting in a car with two other people when the police arrived. The officers involved were responding to a report of a forgery in progress, according to a police department account. Once at the store, they found a man fitting the suspect's description, Floyd sitting in a car. The police department said a physical altercation between the officers and Floyd unfolded after Floyd got out of the car. Now, when you look at the video, we don't see video of an altercation. What we see is he kind of drops to the ground like he's trying to become dead weight so they don't take him. When the officers approached the car, one of them, Thomas Lane, began speaking with Floyd. He pulled his gun and pointed at Mr. Floyd's open window and directed Mr. Floyd to show his hand. It reads, there is no reason stated for why the officer brandished his weapon. The prosecutors say Lane put the gun away once Floyd put his hands on the steering wheel, but put his hands on Mr. Floyd and pulled him out of the car when he ordered him to step out. Floyd then actively resisted being handcuffed. Now, we don't see video of that. I'm not saying it didn't happen. I'm just saying when you look at the video, you have Floyd like on his stomach handcuffed, and he's not resisting arrest. Any one of us would have to admit that at that point of the video. Now, this part is true. You'll see it when you see the whole video. When the officers tried to bring Floyd to their cruiser, he stiffened up, fell to the ground, and told the officers he was claustrophobic. Now, then you have the video. You guys all saw the video. You can watch that. And one of the parts that people don't like is how the one officer is kind of like blocking the view of people trying to film, and it just, maybe he's accidentally doing that, but it just has the impression that, you know, you shouldn't do that. Now, this is the part where when you go into a courtroom, I'm going to talk to you about the legal issues here that you can look into. Is the policy, this is where what it all boils down to, is the policy of the police department, does it allow the officer to do that? See, this is what I'm dreading, because if the officer is found not guilty, we're going to have more riots. And I'm going to predict, I could be wrong, but I'm going to predict that he is found not guilty. And here's why. I'm not saying one way or the other what I would want, because I'm not a jury on the trial, but it says Minneapolis allows the needed neck restraint. Now, this is a problem, because now you're going to hear about what was the officer's intention. Was his intention to, and no disrespect, but to murder George Floyd? And how do you prove intention? Now, let's say we had some cell phone evidence that the officer was racist, and he's like, yeah, I'm going to do this, and he's using the N-word and all that, you know. But how do you prove intention? This is a problem that I see happening where, you know, he may be found not guilty because of this. So it says the technique is allowed in Minneapolis. Now, many of you might be saying, well, why the hell do they allow that technique? Because this could put the officer in the clear where he's like, look, I'm using the technique. You know, now, of course, he's saying he can't breathe and he's saying these things. And I don't know what the policy of the police department is, but I'm going to tell you, you can be sure that the officer's attorney is going to use this as a defense. So now I want you to pretend you're on the jury, and they are going to say to you, is there sufficient amount of evidence to show the officer's intent was to murder George Floyd? And, you know, I have an issue with how do you know what's in the person's brain? And if there's doubt there, how do you know what's in the officer's mind? You know, now, then you have the other side of the coin where this officer was constantly being reprimanded again and again with issues like this. So my theory, just a theory, but my theory is, you know, the supervisors, the head people in the police department, they purposely allow this. They know what's going on. Everyone knows what's going on. I want to tell you what I witnessed one time. And I didn't have a camera or whatever. Well, one time I'm sitting there, you know, eating, you know, and outside the window, I look and I see this guy looking back and looking forth, this, you know, white guy, like probably 18 or 19, 20. And he's got like a mohawk and he looks to the left, looks to the right. And I hear all these sirens, right? And I don't know what that pop-up ad is. It's the video. So I look out the window and literally 1, 2, 3, 4, like 8, 9, 10, 11 police officers at least, and a chopper overhead. I had no idea what this guy did. So the guy went and he climbed up real high on these rocks, and they released the dog, but the dog couldn't go up the rocks. And so they go to tell the guy to get down. He's not getting down. So they start firing the pepper spray gun at him. Just probably like 20, 30 pepper spray thing. Just totally just keep firing and firing. Finally, the guy comes down, and my mom and dad were there. We were all, you know, together as we were eating. And they get the guy. They have him on his stomach. And they start, one of the cops starts punching him in the face with his hands behind his back. And I kept saying I wasn't going to say my opinion, and I'm not going to say my opinion about this episode, but there is an issue with this police brutality. You know, it's quite obvious. I am a Christian conservative. I totally support the police, but there is an issue with police brutality. Everyone knows it. It's out there like the naked emperor. We can't, you know, ignore it. But the solution, I have the solution. The solution is mandatory body cameras always on, and have them in a black box where they cannot be manipulated. Every time a police officer has contact with the public, mandatory body cameras on. Mandatory. And have a policy that if the person's on the ground and you start beating them, another officer must stop that. Otherwise, they all get fired and they lose their retirement and they lose their pensions and everything. That's all you got to do. The supervisors of the police department, they know this. They know that this is going on. You and I know, if you're a supervisor, you know this is going on. I believe they just allow it. Now, let's talk about something, one other thing from a biblical perspective. I've never seen so much ignorance on both sides. Like, you'll have some people that are racist, for example, and they'll talk about the color of the person's skin, and they'll say those N-words, you know, they're always loud, and they're, you know, why did he resist arrest? And some people are mad at every single person that is black because they themselves were harmed by someone, like how Floyd had been arrested before. Let's say Floyd did something to you, you know, he robbed you or whatever. It is total ignorance to then say that all black people, I mean, think of how stupid that is, you guys. I know you agree with me. How stupid can it be that someone has an experience with one person whose skin color happens to be black, and now the ignorance is that we go out and say every single black person is, you know, passing off $20 bills or is a bank robber. I mean, that is so ignorant. Now, let's look at the other side. It's also ignorant that we see a officer, you know, kill, murder, you know, George Floyd. And so we say every officer is a murderer and we need to do away with the police. The ignorance goes both ways. It's easier and lazier just to broad brush it. But the more intelligent person, the person of character, and the person of wisdom takes this as an on a case by case basis. But you know what, ladies and gentlemen? We're just reaping what we're sowing. You could see the murder rate, the rape rate, the unwed pregnancy rate from the time we took the Bible out of schools. It has skyrocketed. The abortion rate. So we reap what we sow. If you want to know who's responsible for this, we are. We reap what we sow. We have turned our backs on God. And when you turn your back on God, you turn your back on love. You turn your back on truth. You turn your back on sanity. And this is why we have madness. And now, because we just read that it's a policy of the police department allows them to do that. I'm going to predict it. All hell is going to break loose when this trial gets over and that officer is found not guilty, because you're going to have to prove that he had intent to harm George Floyd, and the ignorance on both sides of the aisle is going to just create a bigger problem. And this is why each night when I lay my head back on the pillow, I say, Lord, these people that have turned their back on you, they're out of control. Lord, come quickly, return to this earth, take back, you know, what is yours. Can't wait till Jesus Christ returns. He said he is going to rule the world with a rod of iron. You're not going to have all this crap happening anymore when Jesus returns. So we say, Maranatha.